continue our study through this great gospel. And the Lord will have us to be in regard to review. He would have us in chapter 12. And we'll start our reading. It says 42, but I'm actually going to back up and start at verse 39. And it should still be on the same page, 792, if you're using a pew Bible. The Gospel of John, chapter 12. And I'll begin my reading at verse 39. And listen, as usual, Christ is going in toe-to-toe with these Jewish leaders, and he's preaching and teaching truth to them, and they're not hearing it. They're not having none of it. And he's been going back and forth with them. And he begins in verse 39, and he's actually quoting from Isaiah chapter 6, verse 9. And listen, he says in verse 39, if you have that, please say amen.
Amen.
And he says in verse 39, he says, therefore they could not believe, because that Isaiah says here, we know this Greek word, it would be Isaiah. And he says, said again, he had blinded their eyes and hardened their heart, that they should not see with their eyes, nor understand with their heart, and be converted. And he ends verse 40, he says, that I should heal them. And guys, as we look at this verse, it would almost appear that that he's writing or that the prophet is saying that God is actually hardening their hearts and blinding their eyes. And in a way, he really is. But guys, what he's doing here, he's fixing their heart in the condition or the place where in reality, that's where they want it to be. And even in our time, guys, there are folk that hear the word over and over and over, and God gives them chance after chance. And by the way, that's called grace. And listen, we don't know which that point is, but they go past the point where God just says to them that, look, you want it, you got it, you're fixed that way. And not to mention with Israel, look, we know that their hearts have been hardened for quite some time. He delivered them out of Egypt. They came out and listen, got on the prefaces of the promised land, and listen, was still murmuring, still complaining. And we saw that last week. And he got to that place and God said, that's it. You'll go no more with me. This generation will die off, and this generation will wander for 40 years. So these guys, they have a history of that. And here God is fed up with them as well, and has, it appears, by the power of the Holy Spirit, fixed their hearts in the condition where they would want them to be. In verse 41, it says, these things says Isaiah or Esaias. It says, when he saw his glory and spake of him. Now, what we know is that Isaiah, he's talking, he's speaking about God of the Old Testament. He's talking about Yahweh. But we know that God, hallelujah, guys, had put all things in Christ's hands. And what we know is that Christ ultimately is going to be the one to bring judgment. And here with these folk, he's cast judgment on them in regard to their unbelief, and they're stuck in it. And listen, it's all because of that is in reality where they want their hearts to be. In verse 42, he says, nevertheless, among the chief rulers, also many believed on him. And guys, if the verse stopped right there, it would seem like it was a great, great message, a great, great verse. But it doesn't end there. We saw this last week as well. It says, but because of the Pharisees, and listen, by the way, the Pharisees, they weren't gods. They were mere men. It says, because of the Pharisees, they did not confess him, lest they should be put out of the synagogue. And listen, they're worried about the opinion of men. And listen, I said this last week as well. At best, that's weak faith. And we go on, verse 43, he says, for they love the praise of men more than the praise of God. And guys, at worst, it is no faith at all. And listen, I asked that question, I'll answer it again as well. God, in regard to where Christ is, where do we stand? Do we have situational holiness depending on who we're around? If we're around some folk and it seems like they're so numerous that we're going to hold our Christianity real close to our vest because we don't really want no folk to know where we really stand. And listen, it's a question you don't need to answer out loud, but it's one we have all answered to God. Hallelujah, guys,
amen.
Already.
Amen.
In verse 44, he says, Jesus cried and said, he that believeth on me, believeth not on me, but on him that sent me. And again, another inference to the Father that, guys, you can't have one without the other. You can't get to the Father unless you first go through the Son. He goes on, he says, and he that seeth me seeth him that sent me. And in fact, what he is saying is that, look, no Jesus, there's not going to be no God. And listen, you don't have a Son, you don't have the Father, and you surely don't have the Holy Spirit. And you're lost, like that song we just sang, without hope in this world. He says in verse 46, I am come, a light into the world, that whosoever believeth on me should not, look, abide in darkness. And guys, right here, he's talking to them, but he's talking to me too. And listen, he's asking me or telling me that, look, where am I living? How is my life outside of this place? When I'm not at the pulpit, look, how does my life line up with what the Word says? How am I living? Am I abiding in darkness, or am I walking in the light as he is in the light? He says in verse 47, and if any man hear my words and believe not, Christ says, I judge him not, for I came not to judge, he says, the world. And listen, there's a little pause there, and we know that Christ came, but he's talking about, and we know ultimately he's going to judge, but he's saying that this go round, this time when I've come here in the flesh, that I've come for salvation, I've come to save folk, I'm not judging right now. He says, for I came not to judge the world, but to save the world. And listen, he's saying this time, in verse 48, he says, he that rejected me and receiveth not my words. And by the way, guys, how we live or obedience shows whether or not we've truly received. It's not so much of what we're saying, but how are we living? Verse 48, he says, he that rejected me and receiveth not my words, have one, look what he says here, that judges him. And he goes on, he says, the word that I have spoken, the same shall judge him. And he says, in the last day. And listen, we know he's pointing toward the end of human history. And we know there's going to be a time when Christ will come back to judge the world. But what he's saying here, he says, I haven't come to judge right now, but he's saying the words that I'm speaking, and I think about Jesus Christ. In fact, we saw it in the beginning of this book in chapter 1, and he said that, look, all things are made by him, and without him was not anything made that has been made. And we know he was talking about the living word himself, Jesus Christ, who indeed is the creative arm of the Godhead. And I think about that sometimes, and I know that there was nothing. And listen, they spoke heaven and earth to nothing, and nothing had no choice but to obey and become heaven and earth.
Amen.
Speaking something out of nothing, and only they can do that. And I know that toward the end, and Larry, Revelation helps me with that. It says that we'll be with Christ. And listen, even shows some of the garb that we're going to be wearing. And it depicts us of wearing white robes. And I think about that and I say, well, if we're going to battle with Christ, why would we be wearing white? That doesn't seem like very wise battle gear. But what I know is that we're not going to be there fighting. Hallelujah, guys. We're going to be there witnessing the glory of the Lord.
Amen.
And just like he spoke this world into existence, guys, when that time comes, he's going to stand and simply speak that truth. And guess what? Whatever that truth is, whatever he says to them, they're going to have to be obedient to that truth. And during that time, look, it'll be Satan, all those who have followed him. And in essence, he won't say these words, but his truth will say it. The prophets have said it, that in essence, he's going to tell them to go to hell. And ultimately, he says that he's going to take hell and all those that followed him and throw it all in the lake of fire. And what Christ is saying here, that the words that I speak, that they will judge you. And listen, we know that the word, God's word is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. And listen, it cuts right into what's soulish and what is spirit, and knows exactly where you are and what you're doing and when you are doing it.
Amen.
Not just black words or red words on white paper. They're alive. And when God says so, he's going to do away with all sin and sinner, and the chief sinner, who is Satan himself. In verse 49, he says, "For I have not spoken of myself, but my Father which sent me. He gave me a commandment," he says, "with what I should say and what I should speak." And listen, what Christ is saying, that, look, I'm simply here, but I'm being obedient to the Father. And guys, that's a blessing to my heart as well. Because if he's under the umbrella of God, if he's being obedient to God, who should I be being obedient to as well? Because we all have someone over us in authority. And he goes on, he says, well, in verse 50, "And I know that this commandment is life everlasting." He says, "Whatsoever I speak, therefore, even as the Father said unto me, so I speak." And guys, he begins in verse 50, and he speaks about these God's commandments, how they are life everlasting. And in reality, guys, obedience to his truth brings about eternal life.
Amen.
Obedience to what he has said in regard to believing on his Son. Well, that's how we got to be in this privileged position anyhow. We're not that good. We don't look that great. We smell pretty good, but let me tell you something. It took the finished works of Christ for this unholy man to become a holy man, as God, through his Son, has blessed my heart through his Spirit and given me what I did not deserve.
Amen.
Which is eternal life through Jesus Christ, God's only begotten Son. Guys, I ask that you would be prayerful with me as I preach around the subject, Jesus, the righteous King that serves. And Father, as we move into chapter 13 of this great gospel, I pray in the name of Jesus that you will hide me behind the cross of Christ. And Father God, allow these words to be words in which you have given me to speak to this congregation. And Father, as I speak forth these words, Lord, allow me to be first partaker. Let them hit my heart first. And then, Lord, for all who are within the sound of my voice, that you'll minister to them and bless them in a mighty and a special way. For some, dear Lord, they need a healing. For some, dear Lord, they're looking for an answer to prayer. For some, hallelujah, Lord, they may even need to be saved. Well, Lord, you know our hearts. You can see all inside of us. Bless us in the place where we need it the most, as we pray in Jesus' name and for his name's sake, amen.
Amen.
Chapter 13, verse 1, and if I can just squeak one more amen out of you.
Amen.
And he says in verse 1, he says, "Now before the feast of the Passover," and listen, that's what everybody's getting ready for, the Passover. And by the way, this is going to be Christ's last Passover during his earthly time. It says, "When Jesus knew that his hour was come, that he should depart out of this world unto the Father," the verse says, "having loved his own which were in the world," and I love John's verbiage here, he's saying in the world, he's not saying of the world, he says he loved them unto the end. And listen, what John is saying about Christ is that he loved them unto the end. And listen, he's talking about he loved them with that perfect love. And listen, not only did he loved them and will continue to love them all the way through eternity. Amen. So much so that he's about to go to the cross to die for their sins and for our sins too, by the way. So he's talking about that perfect love, that agape love, that forever kind of love. Not like the man kind of love, like we like to throw it out, that eros or that other loves, and then, oh, I love you, and then as soon as you walk away, we ready to talk about you. That's not what he's talking about here. He's talking about he loves us way deep down in his soul. And he's also saying that he loved us so much that, look, you know what? You're going to hell, I'm going to hell, and I'm going to fix it so you don't have to go. I'm going to die in your stead. That's love.
Amen.
And that's love indeed. Verse 2 says, "And supper being ended, the devil, having now put into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him." So we see here that this thing is wrapping up for Christ on earth. And we also see that Judas is getting his final marching orders. And listen, as Christ says that I and my Father are one, what we see here is that Judas and his Father are one, that they're on one accord here. And listen, they're linked, and he's talking to his heart. In verse 3, it says, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he was come, look, from God and went to God. And guys, by the way, Christ knew exactly what it was he was on earth to do. He knew what was coming up. He knew how rough it was going to be for him from the physical. And listen, even with all that, he's still going to willingly go to the cross and perform what the Lord or what God has called him to do. In verse 4, he says, he rises from supper and laid aside his garments and took a towel and girded himself. After that, it says he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel wherewith he was girded. And listen, we know that back then they had no paved roads like we got off, though some of your roads is looking a little raggedy out there. But listen, they had the dirt roads. They were walking around in sandals most of the time. And when you would come into somebody's house, normally they would have a servant. You would sit down and rear back, and the servant would clean your feet off. So they come in the house. Obviously, this man didn't have a servant, and them apostles sure wasn't looking like they would get ready to do nothing. So Christ gets up, and he begins to clean their feet. Verse 6 said, then cometh he to Simon Peter, and Peter saith unto him, Lord, dost thou wash my feet? And listen, we know Peter, he's brash, always wanted to be the first to say something. And listen, the Lord gets to him, and it's as if he's saying, Lord, what are you doing? What are you doing to my feet over here? In verse 7, it says, and Jesus answered and said unto him, what I do thou knowest not now, but thou shalt know hereafter. And listen, what he's saying is, look, you don't quite understand it right now, Peter, but you're going to understand it better by and by. In verse 8, he says, Peter saith unto him, thou shalt, look what he says, he's always definite in his arguments. He said, thou shalt never wash my feet. And listen, with Peter, he's probably right. Because every time we turn around, he got his foot in his mouth, and he couldn't get to him no way. Perpetual foot and mouth disease. He says, you shall never wash my feet. And Jesus answered him, if I wash thee not, thou hast no part with me. And guys, that verse ring to me true all this week. And listen, what the Lord is saying, that, look, we were dirty, all every single one of us. And listen, had the Lord not come along and washed us, we could not have any part with him, because we were not clean, we were dirty, we were funky, we were on our way to hell, and the Lord long comes to the Lord, knowing what we needed, and used scenarios or situations and his truth to bring us under submission to him, so that we could recognize first that we were sinners and had a need of a Savior. And secondly, that he indeed was that Savior. Guys, a lot of times I talk to a lot of people, I minister to quite a few, and what they always are telling me, well, my problem is this. My problem is my husband. My problem is my wife. My problem is my job. My problem, if I could just get over this or just get over that. And listen, what they're telling me about are symptoms. And what Christ has said, no, I need to clean you up, and I need to heal all of your life diseases, because you keep going from one place to another, you're fixing this, and it's like the boy trying to put his finger in the dike. He puts it in one hole, then the springs a leak over here. And he puts it in that hole, and springs a leak over there, and after a while, you're out of hands and you're out of feet. And what I found, even in my life, that the Lord allows things many times, because he wants to get Brother Ralph's attention. And listen, I'm busy about all kinds of things. And the Lord is saying, Brother Ralph, look, you think that you're going the right way. You think that you're doing what I would have you to do. But listen, you need to slow down and stop and listen to me. And he will use whatever he needs in order to get me to hear what it is he's trying to say. Verse 9, it says, Simon Peter saith unto him, Lord. I'm sorry, verse 8. Peter saith unto him, Thou shalt never wash my feet. And Jesus answered him, If I wash thee not, thou hast no part with me. And Simon Peter saith unto him, and only as Simon Peter could say it, and listen, it seems that something has clicked as the Lord is speaking to his heart. It says, Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head. And listen, Simon Peter will go overboard one way or go overboard the other way. He just can't be neutral. Verse 10 says, Jesus saith to him, He that is washed, and I like that. He's talking about those that are saved, those whose sins are forgiven. He says, needeth not save to wash his feet, but is clean every whit. And he says, ye are clean. And listen, it would be a precious verse, and it's precious anyhow, but he keeps going. He says, but not all. And listen, what he's talking about here, first of all, at the end of the verse, he's talking about Judas, and he's going to make that plain. But he said that, look, we're already clean as believers. Christ has died for my sins. All my sins are forgiven, past, present, and future. But as I'm out and about in this sin-sick world, my feet get dirty with the sin of the world. And sometimes I pick up some of that stuff. Sometimes I bring some of it home. Sometimes I trip into some of that mud. Sometimes I willingly go in that mud. And what he's saying is that you're clean as believers, but you get messed up in this sin-sick world. And every once in a while, probably more than every once in a while, we need to go back to the feet of Jesus and say, Lord, look at my feet. I done messed around and stepped in something I had no business, and I'm dirty again. And Lord, though I know you've already forgiven my sins, Lord, I'm messing up my fellowship with you. I'm praying. I'm not hearing the answer to prayer. I'm reading my word, and I'm not really getting what I need to get. Lord, it must be some sin. Lord, I've stepped in something. I've messed up. I've done something wrong. Lord, forgive me. And then I turn and do an about face and repent of that sin. And I don't go back there anymore. Didn't have to get resaved. He already did that. That's for eternity. But I need cleansing every once in a while. And that's what he's sharing with Peter. Then I don't have to wash you all over. You're already okay. But you got issues like your foot and mouth disease. And every once in a while, you need to come to me and allow me to straighten your issues out that you fall in life. In verse 11, it says, For he knew who should betray him. Therefore said he, Ye are not all clean. And guys, when I read verses like that, and I think about we who are believers, and I think about something that perhaps we think we're going to get away with, or something we want to fall back into in regard to sin, or something that's being a temptation, and I'm going to go ahead and go there. If he knew that this man that he chose called Judas was going to betray him, but he allowed him to stay around, he blessed him with truth just like he did everybody else. If he knew what Judas had on his heart, what makes me think he don't know what's on my heart? And listen, even though John don't see me, God sees me. And listen, that should be more of a powerful draw for me not to go there. And keeps me straight. And indeed, it does keep me straight. But what I know is that we're tempted on every side, though temptation is not sin. If we play around with that thing too long in our mind or in our bodies, it can become sin. The Lord helps us to know that. And if he sees him, I know he sees me. I was told by my pastor years ago that God can see a black ant on a black night in the pitch black valley. What makes him think or make me think that he can't see me? Amen. Nobody's getting away with nothing. Amen.
Amen.
He says in verse 11, For he knew who should betray him. Therefore said he, Ye are not all clean. So after he had washed their feet, and had taken his garments, had taken his garments, and was set down again, he said unto them, know ye what I have done to you? And guys, I'm gonna go somewhere else, but in a minute, but I need to explain something. There's no muddy roads out there. There really aren't. And if they are, you're not walking in them, true?
Amen.
So I don't really, when you come in here, I don't need to have a foot washing service. I really don't. But I do need to serve you. I need to outserve you. And listen, Christ is going to show us something in that regard. In verse 12, he says, so after he had washed their feet and had taken his garments and was set down again, he said unto them, know ye what I have done to you? And I would ask that you just place your bulletin there. And we're going to go back to the Gospel of Matthew chapter 20. And we're going to zero in on verse 20. And if you're using a pew Bible, it should be on page 720. Whole lot of 20s. Matthew chapter 20. Zero in on verse 20. And I just want us to see something that the Lord was saying here in Matthew's gospel. Thank you, Lord. Page 720 if you're using a pew Bible. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. See a few pages still turn. Pleasant sound. If we're in Matthew 20, verse 20, please say amen.
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 And Matthew writes here, he says, then came to him the mother of Zebedee's children with her sons, worshiping him and desiring a certain thing of him. So we see here, this is James and John's mom, and listen, they're probably prompted by her to ask this question, or is her herself asking the question. And in verse 21, it says, and listen, she's inquiring of the Lord, it's something she wants, and that's not necessarily a bad thing. In verse 21, he says, and he said unto her, what will thou? And she said unto him, grant that these my two sons may sit, the one on thy right hand and the other on the left, in thy kingdom. And guys, I don't fault these guys too much. I don't come down on them because, look, they have not yet, Christ is still on earth. He's here. So they don't have the Holy Spirit within them, and they're still coming to an understanding, but they're still thinking worldly, and they're thinking that the worldly kingdom is going to be the same as God's kingdom. And he doesn't come down on them too hard, but he does straighten them out. In verse 22, he says, but Jesus answered and said, ye know not what ye ask. And listen, what he's saying, that look, you need to understand that what you're asking is a powerful thing. He says, are ye able to drink of the cup that I shall drink of, and to be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with? And listen, of course, he's pointing toward the cross, and he's been telling them all through his earthly ministry that that's where he was going, and they still had not quite grasped that concept. And at the end of the verse, it says, they say unto him, we are able, not having a full clue as to what Christ was talking about. In verse 23, he says, and he saith unto them, look, ye shall drink indeed of my cup and be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with. And listen, what he's saying, and they still don't get it. He's saying that there's going to be some rough days for you guys when you finally get to the place of true salvation. You have no idea what's coming, but you will drink of the same cup that I have, or will. He says, but to sit on my right hand and on my left is not mine to give, but it shall be given to them for whom is prepared of my Father. And listen, what Christ is saying, that's my Father's call, that's not my call. And listen, he goes on and gives them some more truth as well. In verse 24, he says, and when the ten heard it, they were moved, look what it says, with indignation against the two brethren. Now, these guys are saying that why would you ask him something like that? But guess what? They didn't have the Holy Spirit living inside them either. And they might have been a wee bit ticked off that they didn't get to him and ask the question as well. In verse 25, and Christ uses this as a teaching point. He says, but Jesus called them unto him and said, ye know that the princes of the Gentiles exercise dominion over them. And listen, he's talking about the worldly leaders and how they conduct themselves and how they live. He says, and they that are great exercise authority upon them. And listen, what he's talking about is Satan's world system, that he does what he does. And listen, that's the way the world follows him. In verse 26, he said, but it shall not be so among you. And what he's saying is that, like, guys, among Christians, that's not our way. That's not Christ's way. So that's not our way. We don't work up the corporate ladder. We don't stand and lord over someone. We don't do and cheat and lie and steal to get to the top. And that's what he's saying. That's not our way. He says, but whosoever, look what he says, will be great among you, let him be your minister. And listen, what he's saying, look, you want to be great in God's eyes? Minister to somebody. Help somebody. Come along somebody. Give to somebody. It's not like the world to get and to grab and to take. No, it's not that way in Christ. And he says, you want to be great in God's eyes? Then you serve and be blessed of God to do so. He says in verse 27, and whosoever will be chief among you, let him be your servant. And listen, he's saying in Christ, guys, it's not about getting everything we can get, but it's giving everything we can give. Many times, if I don't see you guys on Sunday, sometimes I'll call or I'll text. And I need you to know that I'm not doing that to try to get in your business or anything. I'm really not. There's true concern there. And if I hadn't heard from you and I don't see you, I don't know if you're sick. I don't know if you're in the hospital. I don't even know if you have a need. And listen, one of my spiritual gifts is the gift of serving. And so when I see somebody in need, I also want to come to their aid. And I understand I can't help everybody. But it is a concern for me when I don't see you, because I don't know what's going on in regard to you being sick or whether or not you have a need. And listen, what Christ is saying to them, that for the believer, you want to be great? Help serve each other. Guys, I was blessed here recently in regard to Jen and John taking over the little hospitality ministry. And listen, many think that that's not a big deal for me, but it frees me up to not have to deal with that. And I have more time to do some things that God has called me to do. It is a great help. That might not seem like it, but it really is. Because whatever I do, I get totally absorbed in it. And listen, where they'll go out and do whatever it is they do, I'm sitting around saying, oh, maybe I should buy this, or maybe I should get that. Oh, I didn't get enough of this, and I'm consumed with that. But now I don't have that to deal with, so guess what I can get consumed with? God's word. He gives me more time for that. And that's a blessing. Listen, before I was concerned about, I'm coming here, I'm picking him. What am I going to sing? Oh, we sang that before, and I'm concerned all about that. I'm knee deep in it. Along comes Brother Larry, and listen, he said, look, I'll be your worship leader. I said, hallelujah. Because I don't really like to stand in front of folks singing. I really don't. It's just that whatever I do, I'm going to do it the best I can, even if I can't sing. But I'm going to do that. So now I don't even have to concern myself with that. All I got to do, look, if I hadn't heard from him by Monday evening, I get on the phone, Brother Larry, I hadn't gotten the songs yet, brother. And listen, then he gives me what I need. I don't have to worry. One less thing for me to worry about. Because in reality, God, as a preacher, God's called me to teach and preach primarily. But as a solo pastor, I've learned that wherever the gap is, I need to fill in. And listen, what he's saying here, and I'm not trying to point myself out to be a super servant, but what I am saying in God's dichotomy, that if there's a need, and you can fill that need, and you know you can fill that need, go fill that need.
Amen.
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 He says in verse 26, but it shall not be so among you. He says, but whosoever will be great among you, let him be your minister. And whosoever will be chief among you, let him be your servant. And listen, to the world, that sounds strange, but in Christ, the economy is great, is how it should be. And verse 28 is the last verse we'll read here in Matthew. It says, even as the Son of Man came, look, not to be ministered unto, but to minister, and to give his life a ransom for many. And guys, that's Christ's example. He came here, and listen, in essence, he came in to die for us. And if he can die for me, the least I can do is make myself available to him and serve as he would have me to serve. I think of Sister Elva, she's 90, whatever. And that's between her and the Lord. But every Sunday, she called me this morning. She said, I don't have a way to get to church. I need to play. My roommate can't bring me. She was concerned about that because she wants to come and serve. Man, that's a blessing. It really is. And I pray at 90. I pray, first of all, I'm still here. But if I'm not, that's okay too. But I pray if I'm still here, and if I am, that I got my wits about me to still be able to do something that's called worthy of God saying I'm okay. I pray that. But a servant's heart, guys, that's what believers, in particular, we who are here today, ought to be focused on serving. And it doesn't necessarily have to be here in this place. There are a ton of folk out there that need help. There are a ton of folk out there that can use our service. Listen, you have neighbors that you should probably see struggling every day. Go to their aid. Ask them if you can help. Be a blessing to them. Find out what their needs are, and then see if you can't meet them and come to us. Maybe we can meet some of their needs and be a blessing to them as well. And God says, as we're doing that, as we're trying to outserve each other, that's when the Father takes notice.
Amen.
And we're not doing it for praise. We're not doing it to show off. We're doing it because it's a desire in our heart to be like who? Yeah. To be like Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
We're back in John chapter 13. Please flip back. Look at verse 12. Amen?
Amen.
It says, so after he had washed their feet and had taken his garments and was set down again, he said unto them, know ye what I have done to you? And ye call me master, verse 13, and Lord, and ye say, well, for so I am. If I then, your Lord and master, have washed your feet, in other words, I served you, he said, ye also ought to wash one another's feet. And again, as I explained, it was needed in that time. We don't really need it right now, but I dare say everybody in here has a need of some sort. And listen, everybody in here can meet the need of someone in this room.
Amen.
In verse 15, he says, for I have given you an example that ye should do as I have done to you. And what he's saying is that in regard to serving, that we ought to humbly serve one another. Not to mention, guys, he's our Lord and Savior. He's our master. He's God's only begotten son. And everybody's sitting around with dirty feet, and everybody's not saying nothing. The man of the house doesn't have a servant. And who jumps up to serve? Jesus. And if he can, my God, we can as well. I rode by somebody the other day, had a flat, and I was going down the road and they had a flat, and I saw them out there, and I didn't know if they had a jack, I didn't know what they had, but I just kept on going. I'm riding. I had an appointment, I'm going to keep my appointment, and I'm driving, and the farther away I got from that car, the more the Holy Spirit convicted me. I said, Brother Ralph, you just drove by there, you don't know if they're all right, you're safe, and listen, you claim you're my son, I mean, you're my child. And listen, I know Satan would beat me up with that and throwing that my way, but guess what? It worked, because I got off the next exit. I came back down. I got off. I came back around and came all the way back around there. And so I went to help, and it happened to be a man and a woman. And I said, listen, I see you guys out here. The Lord had me to come back here to see if I can help you, assist you. You need a jack or something. I got a floor jack in here. He said, oh, no, we don't have a jack. So I'm glad you stopped what they said. We don't have a spare either. Now, I choked their tire, and I had a pump in my van. I tried to pump it up, and the thing was just shot. It wouldn't hold air. So what I ended up doing was giving them a ride. I took them somewhere. because they was not going to do in regard to buying them attire at that time. But I'm just saying that in of myself, I should have stopped anyhow. And listen, I know how in these days a lot of times folk don't want to stop because they don't know if it's safe or not safe. And you got to use discernment with that. But the moment I saw them, the Spirit said stop, and I should have heeded him the first time. But I went and rectified that and went back. And listen, still was a blessing to those folk, and they were oh so appreciative, trying to give me money. I'm saying, no, that's okay. I took them to a gas station where they called, and they were able to get somebody to come and bring a tire and that kind of thing. But I was convicted of that. And listen, only because I am a servant of God, and he has called me to serve. Does that make sense?
Amen.
He's called us to serve. And serve we should. Verily, verily, he says in verse 16, I say unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord, neither he that is sent greater than he that sent him. In verse 17, guys, and this is key, he says, if ye know these things, look what he says, happy are ye if you do them. And listen, what he's talking about here is obedience. That if we know that we ought to do those things, and how many times do we push past those things to go ahead and keep our agenda? But he's saying if we know them and do them, happy are we. In other words, he's saying we're blessed of God, and we have the joy of the Lord, and he for sure is pleased. He says in verse 18, I speak not of you all. I know whom I have chosen. And again, he's speaking of the 12, but he knows exactly who Judas is. He says, but that the scripture may be fulfilled, he that eateth bread with me hath lifted up his heel against me. And again, he's quoting Psalm 4 and 9, but he's of course speaking about Judas, whom again Christ knows. In verse 19, he says, now I tell you before it come, that when it is come to pass, ye may believe that I am he. And again, he's talking about Judas' betrayal, and he's trying to let them know what's going on, and ultimately his crucifixion. Verse 20 says, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that receiveth whomsoever I send receiveth me, and he that receiveth him that sent me, he that receiveth me, he says, and that receiveth me receiveth him that sent me. Of course, he's talking about him as well as his Father. And listen, he's talking about receiving his servant, that he's going to receive him, Christ, and receive the Father as well. Verse 21 says, when Jesus had thus spoke, he was troubled in his spirit and testified and said, verily, verily, I say unto you, that one of you shall betray me. And listen, he knew, had the foreknowledge, he knew who Judas was when he chose him, and he knew he was going to betray him. And listen, his heart is aching a bit because he knows what's getting ready to come up. In verse 22, it says, then the disciples looked one on another, doubting of whom he spake. And truly, they didn't know who it was. They didn't even know if it was themselves. In verse 23, it says, now there was leaning on Jesus' bosom one of his disciples whom Jesus loved. And guys, I always loved this verse 23, because the writer of this gospel is John, and he's speaking of himself. He's the one that Jesus loved. But guess what? He's only writing what the Lord gave him to write, and so write it he does. Verse 24, Simon Peter therefore beckoned to him that he should ask who it should be of whom he spake. And he then lying on Jesus' breast saith unto him, Lord, who is it? And again, questioning themselves. And Jesus answered, he it is to whom I give or shall give a sop when I have dipped it. And when he had dipped the sop, he gave it to Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon. And listen, even after doing that, they still didn't quite get what he was trying to say, not sure why. And listen, if you're from up north, you might not know what a sop is, but it's simply a piece of bread dipped in whatever liquid it is and lapping it up. And if you're from the south, I already know you know what a sop is. And listen, and that's all he's talking about. But still, it appeared that they didn't still know what was going on. In verse 27, it says, and after the sop, look what the verse says, Satan entered into him. And listen, he had already, Satan had already talked to him saying, we getting ready to do it. Get ready, my son Judas. But here it says that he entered into him. And guys, what I know of believers is that we have God's Holy Spirit in us. And I know that Satan can beat on your door, he can trouble you, he can bother you, but he can't enter into you because you're already full. And listen, even for his disciples, Christ was with them, they were protected by him, but this guy Judas and his heart was never linked with Christ. And we see here that Satan is saying, look, we're going to do this, and I'm going to make sure my man's not going to back off, so I'm going to enter inside of him. And now even if Judas wanted to, he couldn't back off of this dastardly deed that him and his father had decided to do. Guys, verse-wise, I'm going to stop right there because we have a song coming from our song master, Mr. Larry, at the very end of the service. So I'm going to give him time to be able to sing. But I also want to let you know that there are folk that do things in this world, and many times we're wondering, well, how could somebody do that? How could a mother kill their kids, or a father kill their kids, or kill their whole family? How could somebody just go in and shoot folk all the way around? How come there's so much mental illness going on around? And guys, I'm not saying that all of it is demon possession or demon oppression, but what I am saying that it all comes straight from the pits of hell.
Amen.
And when you hear about somebody that does something like that, it always, every time later on they ask them, well, what happened and why did you do it? They don't even know what occurred most of the time. And listen, this same Satan that entered into Judas and did the dastardly deed, it was all part of what God knew was going to happen anyhow. But still, was with the 12. Learned all the same words and truths, or heard all the same truths that they heard, was in the face of Jesus Christ, knowing what he was going to do, Christ knowing what he was going to do, and yet and still he allowed him to stay. And even here, he points him out. And obviously, he acted so well and was such a fraud that even his boys that was with him did not even realize who he was. Guys, if we're in Christ, it ought to show in how we conduct ourselves. And if we're not, it's going to show as well.
Amen.
The topic of this sermon was Jesus, the righteous King that serves. How about we begin to do what he did and be a blessing to others that we encounter? And don't do like Brother Ralph and drive past him. Stop. Be a blessing. See if your neighbors need a hand. If you see somebody distressed, don't pass them by. Just simply serve them. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
Brother Larry?
Amen.
Before I do this song, I want to kind of let you know a little bit about why I'm doing this song. Many of you don't know me. Some of you do, and some of you know of what I have done in the past. For some 30-odd years, I was a professional musician. I worked with a lot of the big names in country and western music. And I had many people say to me, why don't you cut a record? That kind of amazed me right there, doesn't it? But anyhow, I had always thought about doing that, but something always came up. Finally, after a lot of years of working with a lot of the big names in country western music, I realized that this just wasn't going to fit. I gave up on music, I quit. I quit singing altogether. And for about 7 or 8 years, I'm a tune now and then, but that was it. Never anything more than that. Then I had a lady come to me in church one time and said, you know, I've heard you singing back here in the congregation, and we'd like to have you sing in the choir. And I said, nope. don't do that. That's not my thing. I don't serve in the choir. But she just kept after me, and I finally said, you know, maybe I could a little bit. So I started back singing in the choir. The longer I kept working at it, the more God dealt with me. The more he showed me the reason why I never made it in country western music, he had something else in mind for me. So after a lot of years of saying, or hearing people say, you got to cut a record, I finally did. And it was gospel music. It was God's music. And this is one of the songs that was in it, mainly because it pretty much tells the story of this old person right here. It's called, I Can't Even Walk Without You Holding My Hand.
Down on my knees, that's where I
Heavenly Father, we just thank you, dear Lord, for just using us and blessing us and ministering to us, Father God, and through word and through song, Father God, how we realize and recognize that there's nothing we can do within ourselves, but all we can do, Father, we can only do if we're connected to you. Father, we ask in the name of Jesus for each and every one that's assembled here, that you'll minister to them and bless them, and Father God, grow them in the knowledge of who you are and what you have for them in their lives. Father, I pray that with everyone on our prayer list, that you'll minister and bless as you see fit. And Father God, for this collection of believers, that you'll continue to send us out into this world, and not to be of this world, but in it to be a blessing as we serve under the name and umbrella of Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you, we praise you, we say yes to your will and to your way on this day and every day, as we pray in Jesus' name and for his name's sake, amen.
Amen.
God bless you guys. Well done.